Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Stephanie Carnes. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
And here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you'd like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
You can also send us your comment on our new website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your comment.
We'll get to our brain teaser in just a moment, but first we wanted to remind viewers that Patrick Stenshorn from the Women's Rights National Historic Park will be here a little later in the show to talk to us about the Women's Rights Convention.
All right, now let's get to tonight's brain teaser.
This American author was born on April 18, 1926 in Monroeville, Alabama. She attended the University of Alabama and Huntington College in Montgomery. There she wrote short stories and other works on racial and social injustice, a rare subject for the time.
In 1960, she published her only novel, To Kill a Mockingbird, for which she won a Pulitzer Prize and is considered, to this day, the most widely read piece of literature dealing with race issues.
If you think you can solve our brain teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we added to our Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. We got a lot of state testing going on, but you have a problem that you were working with some kids in school.
Yes, today I was working with a lovely student on some geometry. And
excellent.
So I picked out a geometry question, so hopefully she's watching right now so she can check it out.
Excellent.
I already put it on the board, so if you want to follow me, we can go ahead and take a look. All right, so this geometry question has to do with two similar triangles. So let's go ahead and read through and see what it's about. It says Maria is 4 feet, 2 inches tall. To find the height of a flagpole, she measured her shadow and the pole's shadow. What is the height, H, of the flagpole? And you can see they gave us this diagram and they told us she's 4 feet, 2 inches tall. And here's the height of the flagpole. So that's what we're gonna find out. So it looks like the shadows, when they measured the shadow of the flagpole, it was 20 feet. And when they measured her shadow, it was 3 feet and 4 inches. So using similar triangles is going to be the way to go. But the first thing I noticed was we have a lot of units to deal with. I have 4 feet, 2 inches, 3 feet, 4 inches. And I want to put that all in one common unit so I can work with those numbers. So since we have inches, I thought if we took 4 feet, 2 inches and we converted that to how many inches, not only she'll feel taller, right, because that'll be a bigger number, but we can go ahead and do that with all our numbers. So let's go ahead and get started. First off, if I have 4 feet, remember each foot is 12 inches. So if I have 4 feet, 2 inches, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna multiply that 4 feet by 12. Then I'm gonna add on her 2 inches. And it'll tell me the number of inches for her height. So I went ahead and I put the calculator up so we could multiply that out. We could do this in our head, or sometimes calculator, just check your work, make sure you didn't make a mistake. So we have 48, I'll add two more on, and that'll be 50 inches. So Maria's height is 50 inches. So I'm gonna go ahead and mark that there. And let's do the same thing with her shadow. Her shadow was 3 feet, 4 inches. So I'll go ahead and I'll multiply the 3 feet by 12, and then I'll be adding on that 4 inches, and we'll find that out. So 3 times 12 is 36, add four on, so 3 times 12, then we'll add four more on, and that should be up to 40, so good. 40 inches, okay, that's a little low on your screen, but 20 feet is gonna be a lot of inches. So I know 20 feet's huge, but if I multiply that by 12, That's going to be 240 inches. Okay, so that is quite a shadow. All right, so now all my units are the same. They're in inches. So now I can go ahead and work on the geometry part. And we're going to look at the fact that these are really similar triangles. And since they're both right triangles, we're going to use a proportion to set this up and go ahead and solve. So I went ahead and I just want a clean screen so we have a little more room to work. Let's take a look. I'm going to make two ratios. So my first ratio, I'm going to do the height over the shadow. So I'm going to leave h as a variable. That's what we're going to find out. And then my shadow was 240. Now I want to do the same thing with Maria's shadow and her height. I want to do her height on the top and her shadow on the bottom. So I'm going to go ahead and put 50 in over her shadow was 40. Now at this point, this should look familiar to us. We have a proportion, so I know if I cross multiply, I can pretty quickly solve for our variable h and get a solution. So we'll go ahead and multiply. I have 40h. So I'm going to write it over here this time. And when I do the other side, I have a pretty big number. I know I have to multiply 240 times 50. So I'm going to go ahead back to that calculator. Oh, I have a little circle there, but that's okay. I'll move it over here. So I have 240 times 50. And that is 12,000. All right, so one more step to do. My next step should be go ahead and divide both sides by 40, and that way I'll have h by itself. Right, I'll cross it out, and I'll have h equals, but we know whatever we do to one side, we always do it to the other. So now I can just take my calculator, and I'll go ahead and divide by 40. Whoops, let's go ahead and do that. Divided by... Oh, one more time, I was off a zero. Always check your work, right? We want to make sure we're accurate here. I'll divide that by 40, and I get 300. Okay, so you might say 300 feet, right? But think back to what we did. We changed that to inches. So the height of this flagpole, I know, is 300 inches. But you're probably wondering, how many feet is that, right? So how do I turn that back into feet? Well, I know every foot is 12 inches, so I'm going to go ahead and divide this by 12, and that will be 300 divided by 12. Finally, my answer is going to be 25 feet. So final answer. So using that shadow, those shadows could be useful if you have something really tall to measure. If you know that you have two right triangles, you can go ahead and measure your shadow and use that proportion to go ahead and solve. So I hope that helped you out, Fatuma. Thank you for watching.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
We'll get back to the questions in just a moment. But first, in tonight's New York State of Mind, we visit the Women's Rights National Historic Park in Seneca Falls, New York, to find out some of the first steps that women took towards equal rights. Check it out.
My name is Patrick Stenshorn. I'm a park ranger at Women's Rights National Historical Park. Here at the park, we celebrate the first Women's Rights Convention, which was held in Seneca Falls in July of 1848. It's seen as the start of the women's rights movement here in the United States. And we honor that legacy of not just the convention, but also the five main organizers, Elizabeth K. Stanton, Lucretia Mott, Mary Ann McClintock, Jane Hunt, and Martha Wright. They met at the home of Jane Hunt on July 9, 1848, and they discussed this idea of having a women's rights convention.
In this country, a woman was not given full rights at all. If you were a married woman, you couldn't inherit property, which meant you couldn't have a bank account, you couldn't enter into a contract, you couldn't rent a room or have an apartment.
They then met again at the home of Marian McClintock on July 16, 1848, and drafted a document known as the Declaration of Sentiments, which would become sort of the founding document comparable to the Declaration of Independence for the American Revolution, but it would be the founding document for the women's rights movement. It would set out the list of demands that women would want to achieve. And they changed probably the most famous line from the Declaration of Independence of, "We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal," to be more explicit that "we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men and women are created equal." Elizabeth Cady Stanton is one of the main leaders of the women's rights movement. Now, in the 1848 convention, she's seen largely as the driving force, the one who organizes it. She is actually the one who drafts the Declaration of Sentiments, and she is the one who puts all of those demands for women's equality in there. And then they arrived here at the Wesleyan Chapel in Seneca Falls, and they held a convention on July 19th and 20th, 1848.
In that era, they called conventions to get people together of like mind to kind of talk over the issues and to talk about how are we going to advocate, how are we going to push for this. And so that first women's rights convention in Seneca Falls was groundbreaking. There were men and women gathered together discussing an issue. In the early days of our country, there were actually women who were punished for speaking to groups of men. You actually could be exiled from Massachusetts. You could actually be put in prison, or you could even, in some cases, lose your life. Here, in Seneca Falls, they dared to have a whole convention, men and women together, to talk to a political issue and to say, how can we raise the rights and bring the issues of women's roles in our community to the forefront? And it was men and women, and there they were, and it was totally groundbreaking to do it.
The 1848 convention is significant because it really is a second American Revolution. It is a place where half of the population demands equality. Their freedoms were going to be achieved.
If you would like to see this video again or others like it, go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right, and tonight on Hotline, we would like to welcome Patrick from the Women's Rights National Historic Park.
Thanks
Thank
for coming
for
in, Patrick.
Here.
Thanks for having
Thank
me.
You.
Thanks for having
you.
Me.
All right, so can you talk a little bit about the five key women that planned the Seneca Falls Women's Convention?
Sure. The convention was organized by five women: Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Lucretia Mott, Jane Hunt, Marian McClintock, and Martha Wright.
Okay.
Out of those five, four of them are actually of the Quaker religion. The only one who is not is Elizabeth Cady Stanton.
Really?
And they are all involved in movements like abolition and temperance prior to getting involved in women's rights. And they are very active, they're educated women, and they're people who really want to make a change in the world.
Fantastic. Now, you were saying that this place is a federal
yes.
park.
Yes, it is part of the national park system. We are one of the 400 national parks, along with Yellowstone.
So the reason I say that is that there's no cost to get into this.
There's no cost.
Fantastic. So now, can you tell us why that Susan B. Anthony wasn't at this huge convention that they're all rallying to go to? What took place that she couldn't be there?
So that's a great question. It's one of the questions we get asked the most at the park. Everybody knows Susan B. Anthony, associates her with the women's rights movement.
Right.
In 1848, she's actually teaching out in Canajoharie, New York, which is about 100 or so miles east of Seneca Falls.
Yeah.
She's not involved in women's rights yet,
She does not get involved in women's rights until 1851, when she goes to Seneca Falls for an anti-slavery convention, and there she actually meets Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Elizabeth Cady Stanton sort of befriends her, and they become best friends.
Because they always mention Susan B. Anthony, so you always think that she was always right there on the forefront with the women's rights.
Yeah, a lot of people think that.
Wow.
So where did these women stood in terms of society? Where did they stand in terms of class?
All five of them are middle to upper class women. They all have the means to get an education, which was unusual for women in the 1800s. Generally, women would not get the same education as a young boy would. But these women were actually a little bit wealthier, so they had that ability to get an education. As they get older, they then can hire house help to do the cleaning, the cooking, things like that, things that lower class women would not have the opportunity to do, and that allows them to go outside the home and do work in abolition, in women's rights, in temperance, things that lower class women just would not have had.
Not only that, but they must have had really, how did their husbands think of their work, really?
Their husbands, for the most part, are actually supportive. Out of those five women, three of their husbands actually signed the Declaration of Sentiments, and a couple of them actually chair some sessions of that convention. So it was actually men who chair the convention. They preside over the convention. And Jane Hunt's husband, Richard Hunt, and Mary Ann McClintock's husband, Thomas, and Lucretia Mott's husband, James, all chair sessions of the Women's Rights Convention.
Fantastic.
Wow, wonderful.
So now, Seneca Falls, long way from Washington, D.C. Why was Seneca Falls chosen for this place, or for this convention?
Part of it is actually just convenience. Out of those five women, four of them live in the central New York area. So Elizabeth Cady Stanton lives in Seneca Falls. Martha Wright lives in Auburn, New York. Okay. And then Mary Ann McClintock and Jane Hunt live in Waterloo. The only one who didn't was Lucretia Mott. But Lucretia Mott was actually Martha Wright's sister. And Martha was actually pregnant at this time. So Lucretia was coming to the area to visit her sister. And while she was there, Lucretia and Elizabeth had become friends about 8 years earlier. And they decided, let's get together. Right. And they decided to plan this convention.
Cool.
So speaking of the convention, what rights were we talking about? What were the women fighting for?
They were looking for a whole range of rights, political, economic, social. At this time, women are really in no way equal to men. Probably the right to vote gets the biggest headlines.
Sure, yeah.
They're fighting for the right to vote, because with the vote, they can have representation in the government, which they do not have. But they're also looking for equal access to education. Women would not get the same education as young boys at this time. They're looking for access to equal employment. So men are the doctors, are the lawyers, are the politicians. Women are the cooks and the cleaners. They want to be the doctors. They want to be the lawyers. And they want that equal opportunity. And pay. Yep. It was actually an employer's right to pay a woman's husband, even if she worked outside the home at this time. And they're looking to change that. They're looking to become equal in all facets of life.
So with the women's rights and how they progress now, what are some of the struggles that they're still encountering today?
Well, today, you know, women have achieved the right to vote. They achieved the right to vote with the passage of the 19th Amendment in 1920. But a lot of those issues like education and employment are still being fought today. You know, we see a great increase of women going to college today, but a lot of times they're not getting the jobs, the same types of jobs that men would get. So men are still CEOs of companies. Men are still the partners in law firms or the chief surgeons in hospitals, where women are not. And women are still only earning roughly 75 cents per dollar that every man makes for the exact same job. So there's still a long way to go to achieve that equality.
Yeah, neat. So back to your job a little bit. If we plan a trip out to Seneca Falls
Which
National
Park. Which we hope
you do. Yes,
absolutely.
Definitely worth it. What would we see?
Well, you'd see we have several different historic properties. We have the Wesleyan Chapel, where the 1848 convention was actually hosted. We have Elizabeth Cady Stanton's home in Seneca Falls. We also own the home of Mary Ann McClintock and Jane Hunt there in Seneca Falls.
Very nice.
And we have a visitor center that's in a historic property as well, which hosts a video called Dreams of Equality and some exhibits and a beautiful statue, which sort of represents the people who attended that 1848 convention.
Right.
And we also can come and see you.
And you can
right,
see
Pat?
Us. You can see the lovely Rangers who are there.
So now, just on a side conversation, the Wesleyan church that's there, is that related to like the Wesleyan College here in Rochester and Churchville there?
I'm not 100% sure. It might be. It is. The Wesleyan Chapel is it's a sect of the Methodist Church.
Okay.
Following a man named John Wesleyan, who in the late 1700s declared slavery evil, and he broke off from the mainstream Methodists.
Wow.
So it very well might be. It might be part of the same line of the Methodist faith.
Great. I'm glad you came on, Patrick. We're going to come down and pick your brain this summer.
I hope you do.
Yeah,
thank you very
so much.
Great
to
thank
see
you for having me.
All right. If you would like to go visit Patrick, please do. Go down to the Seneca Park or the Seneca. And we're going to go over to a question that I have reviewing some science stuff.
You do some science.
Yes,
yeah,
I
think it's science
yes.
time.
All right. So, again, we have been reviewing test-taking strategies that you can use on any kind of multiple choice test that you're going to take. In science, I always go back to telling my students it's vocabulary. You got to know what the words mean before you can even look at trying to get one of the answers correct. So we read along. It says goats have been genetically modified to produce an anti-clotting protein in their milk. So they're going to make something that's going to keep blood from clotting. And the protein is extracted from the milk and given to people who have an inherited disorder. So they have something in their genetics that causes their bodies to produce blood clots. Now, if you ever had a blood clot or a scab on the outside, you know it's hard. Well, that same thing can happen inside your veins, which can cause and be very fatal, all right? A benefit of this technology is used to produce a protein that now, here's where you gotta find out. What does this protein or what's it gonna do for me or for you if you actually take this, all right? We're gonna look at all of our choices. Now we're gonna come back and pick out which one is the most correct. Can it be used to overcome the effects of a harmful mutation? Can it provide people with a new kind of nutrient-rich milk? Will result in healthier goats with more nutritious milk for their offspring? Or will reduce blood clots in other farm animals that are modified in this way? So now you got to go back and think, okay, what are we looking to get? We're talking about anti-clotting proteins. We're talking about them taking it out of the goats and putting it in humans to help them overcome an inherited disorder. Something in their genetics is causing them to make blood clots in their systems. And if they do this, it's going to benefit us because why? All right. Well, when I look at these, I say it can be used to overcome the effects of a harmful mutation. I'm thinking that one might be a really, really good choice right off the bat. But let's go look at our other choices. Can provide people with a new kind of nutrient-rich milk. Well, that might be the case, but they're not really asking us that in the question. They're asking us about how is this going to affect an inherited disorder. You might want to try some goat's milk cheese, but it's not going to be our best choice answer there. Will this result in healthier goats with more nutritious milk for the offspring? Once again, if they're taking this out to help humans, it's not really going to affect the milk or the nutritional value that the goats produce for their own offspring. The last one, it says, will reduce blood clots in other farm animals that are modified in this way. Well, it could be possible that could be, but when they talk here, they're saying it's being introduced into people that have blood clots. So they're actually taking it out of the goats and putting it in humans. All right. So again, we go back and we look, it says could be used to overcome the effects of a harmful mutation. That's going to be our most correct choice, and you're going to want to stick with that one. You circle it, put the answer on your bubble sheet, make sure that you don't change it. And again, vocabulary, read the question, take your time, call us so we can get you here live on TV. Thank you.
Some of the most famous composers, such as Mozart, Strauss, and Schubert, were born in this musically inclined country. There are about 8 million people that live in Austria, and 98% of them speak German. Austria is divided into 9 independent federal regions, and parts of the movie The Sound of Music were shot in the city of Salzburg. Austria was also the first country to use postcards.
We have a winner in tonight's brain teaser.
Joanna, are you out there?
Yes.
Hi, Joanna. Who is this person that we're talking about tonight?
Harper Lee.
Fantastic.
Harper Lee, very good. Now, how did you find your answer?
Well, first I went on Google, and then
perfect.
I searched the book that he wrote, and it just showed up.
Fantastic.
Perfect. Good.
All right. Well, that's good. Have you read this book?
No.
No, no. My son is in eighth grade right now, and I know his class just finished reading it. So what grade are you in, Joanna?
I'm in fourth.
Fourth. Okay, so you'll probably be reading it in a couple years. But good, and good job on Google, too.
Yes, especially because it helps some of our other viewers on what kind of keywords you're looking for when you put that stuff into the search engine there.
All right, good. Well, thanks for calling, Joanna.
Congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
All right, and that's all the time we have here for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial a Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Don't forget to tune in tomorrow for our Hotline Book Reviews.
All right, good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.